Hello again, I'm John McGovern, and today I'm going to be talking about book two of Edmund Spenser's poem, The Faerie Queene. As I explained last time, there are six books in The Faerie Queene, and each book has a different knight as the main character, and each of the six knights represents a different Christian virtue. And the virtue in book two is temperance, or in other words, self-restraint and moderation. And Guyon is assisted by a character called the Palmer, in other words, a pilgrim who wears black and carries a white staff. And the Palmer represents reason unmixed with passion. Rather than explaining the entire plot of book two, I've decided to pick out a few of the key episodes and explain their significance. So first of all, in Canto 3, we are introduced to a character called Braggadocio. And braggadocio remains quite a common word in the English language. As you probably know, if someone's always boasting, you might say that they're guilty of braggadocio. But it's less commonly known that this word seems to have been invented by Edmund Spenser in this very poem. And it's sort of a mock Italian word, a mock Italian word meaning someone who is boastful. Braggadocio is always talking about his heroic deeds, but it's all words and no action. In one passage he says, "With one sword, seven knights I brought to end," or "I killed seven knights with one sword." But in reality, he's weak, cowardly, and incompetent. And the point of this episode is that it's important to distinguish between real courage and mock courage. People who set themselves up as competent, but really they're just a shadow of true competence. They're really impotent and incapable.
Gilderoy Lockhart, Order of Merlin, third class, honorary member of the Dark Force Defense League, and five times winner of Witch Weekly's Most Charming Smile Award.
Then follows a particularly complicated episode centering around a character, an ogre called Furor, who represents unbridled rage, and his mother, Occasion, who is modelled on the classical figure Occasio. The episode is quite abstract and complex, but the message seems to be that you can't just defeat rage through curing rage itself. You have to find the root of the problem, find out the source of the rage and attack that. And that's the only way it's possible to defeat it. Guyon vanquishes two further opponents, one called Pyrocles, who represents willful rage. So while Furor had represented rage, uncontrolled rage or rage which happens of its own accord, Pyrocles represents deliberate willful rage. And then he defeats Symocles, who represents willful self-indulgence. And once these two foes are vanquished, Guyon continues on his quest. Then comes the interesting scene of the Idle Lake. And just as the Red Cross Knight in the previous book fell victim to pride, in this book, Sir Guyon falls victim to desire, and the Idle Lake is the setting for this episode. He is seduced by a character called Phaedria, who is the Lady of the Lake. And the moral of the story is that in accepting pleasure, he forsakes his mission, which is a really important thing which he has to do. He chooses pleasure instead. Every detail of the Idle Lake is deliberately designed to be sensuous. For example, the boat in which he is rowed along the lake is a gondola, calling up images of romantic boat rides in Venice. And The fact that Phaedria rows the boat is also important, because it signifies that she is in control and he has surrendered his power. While Guyon is sleeping, Phaedria rows him far away from his proper course. And when he wakes up, he's angry because it finally dawns on him that he's made a big mistake and he's veered far away from his true purpose. But Phaedria refuses to take any of the blame, and instead she criticizes the masculine code of knighthood. She says, "Debateful strife and cruel enmity, the famous name of knighthood foully shunned, but lovely peace and gentle amity, and in amours the passing hours to spend, the mighty martial hands do most commend. Of love they ever greater glory bore than of their arms. Mars is Cupido's friend, and is for Venus love's renowned more than all his wars and spoils, the which he did of yore. So it's a bit of specious logic where she's saying, it's even more heroic to be in love than to continue on your quest. There are lots of literary echoes here. For example, one we talked about last time, Aeneas settling down with Dido and forgetting about his true mission, or Samson being seduced by Delilah in the Bible, in the book of Judges. And this is a particularly interesting episode, which was later dramatized by John Milton in the poem Samson Agonistes. Softened with pleasure and voluptuous life, at length to lay my head and hallowed pledge of all my strength in the lascivious lap of a deceitful concubine, who shore me like a tame wether, all my precious fleece, then turned me out ridiculous, despoiled, shaven, and disarmed among my enemies. So this idea that, not that all romance is bad, but the wrong kind of romance can easily turn you away from the proper course and turn you away from the accomplishments which you ought to be working towards. But going back to the Faerie Queene, Guyon ultimately parts and continues on his quest. Skipping forwards a bit, Guyon, who is now accompanied by Prince Arthur, finds his way to a castle called the Castle of Alma, or alternatively, the House of Temperance. And Alma, of course, means soul. So Alma represents the soul, the rational soul, which is in control of the entire body. The castle is interestingly compared to a human body. So every part of the building represents another feature of the body. For example, the door of the castle represents the human mouth, and there is a porter who guards the mouth and makes sure that no unbecoming words can exit out of it. Within the barbican, a porter sate, day and night duly keeping watch and ward. Nor wight nor word mote pass out of the gate, but in good order, and with due regard, utterers of secrets he from thence debarred, babblers of folly and blazers of crime. His larum bow might loud and wide be hard, when cause required, but never out of time. Early and late it rung, at evening and at prime. And the most interesting part of all is the tower, representing the mind. And the tower is ruled by three counsellors. Firstly, Phantastes, who represents ideas and the power of prediction. And secondly, an unnamed counsellor who represents knowledge of present affairs and political prudence and political knowledge. And the third is Umnestes. I hope I'm pronouncing that right. It's after the Greek Umnestes, who represents knowledge of the past, or so book knowledge, wisdom, knowledge of past histories and past affairs. And this has an obvious political application. So if you were choosing a decision for a government, you need to be willing to try new ideas. You need to have a knowledge of present common sense, and you also need to know what worked and what didn't work in the past. So the idea is all these things have to be in perfect balance. And not only does it have a political application, but it also has an application to everybody's life as well. And even in our own small scale decision making, it's a good idea to have these three faculties in due proportion. At this point in the poem, Guyon picks up a couple of books in the library. One of them is called Britain Monuments, so an ancient history of Britain. And the other one called The Antiquity of Fairyland. So that's the history of the world in which Guyon comes from. And there are a pair of very interesting digressions when Spenser sort of looks inside the books and narrates the contents of the books. And I won't get into that now, but if you're interested in that, then of course you can go ahead and look at those yourself. Guyon then avoids the perils of the Gulf of Greediness, the Rock of Reproach, and the Wandering Islands, and finally makes his way to the Bower of Bliss. And the Bower of Bliss represents unbridled pleasure, luxury, a lack of restraint. And everything in the Bower of Bliss is artificial. The flowers and the plants are made of gold, and even the birds turn out to be fake. It turn out to be artificial. They sing in a way which is unnatural, in a structured way which is contrary to nature. And if anyone's read the great novel by Philip K. Dick, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? I don't know about you, but for me, it reminds me of this book. Because in that book, Deckard is disappointed when he realizes an owl is artificial because it's set in a dystopian future where the only animals surviving are robotic animals which look exactly like the real thing but turn out to be ersatz. Despite the artificial beauty of the bower, Guyon and the palmer mercilessly raise it to the ground and they free the prisoners of Acrasia. Acrasia is the wicked witch who has sort of has lots of lovers who are in love with her but also her prisoners. And Spenser writes, "But all those pleasant bowers and palace brave, Guyon broke down with rigor pitiless, ne aught their goodly workmanship might save them from the tempest of his wrathfulness. But foot that their bliss he turned to balefulness, their groves he felled, their gardens did deface, their arbours spoil, their cabinets suppress, their banquet houses burn, their buildings race, and of the fairest late now made the foulest place." And this quite obviously represents the final defeat of luxury and self-indulgence by the power of temperance. But not everybody is happy about this. There's a man called Grill, whom Acrasia had turned into a pig. And when the palmer turns him back into a human, he's angry. And the idea is that not everybody is content to live a moral, temperate life. And this is also loosely based on a scene from Homer's Odyssey. So that's the conclusion of the book. Guyon completes his quest by destroying the Bower of Bliss and thus restoring temperance to its rightful place in the Christian code of conduct. And that's a brief summary of book two. And next time, I'll be analyzing book three of the poem. So I look forward to seeing you in the next video. If you liked it, please like and subscribe so you can see more content like this in the future.